Thank you. You're live to the world on Facebook. All
right.
I'll just do a quick shot around.
Nice big crowd tonight. And I'm just, hey, can you go stand behind the pulpit? You want to go stand in for this so I can get it? Just, I want to get it adjusted, you know? Hey, good to see you again. Yeah, I think that works. It's good.
No, I might.
Hey, Rob, would you stand behind this for a second?
Stand behind here?
Yeah, and then come down to my height for a second. I'm just trying to.
I'm the guinea pig.
I'm just setting this thing up here.
But it's not someone asking where you want those books.
Yeah, I was saying to just put them on that table, wherever people took stuff away, to stack DVDs. Stack them high. Yep. That guy, you want to say
hi? I can tell you. Because Texas actually takes up.
No, honestly, it's just a shocker.
Yeah, that's Texas right there.
Pretty much.
And then in your mind.
You're just so based in Texas. What do you do?
That's my friend Marco. I know, look at this white. I can do what? I know. My grandma actually just wanted this. I was going to make a because he's like my dad wasn't even once or twice when we're talking. And he's told me stuff not just because of the PTSD. Because he killed people for seeing what we're doing.
Thank you. album on the front, that would be filled up with the CD. Let's turn to song number 449, song number 349, Welcome to the Land.
Far away, the noise of strife upon my ear is falling. Then I know the sins of the loud and clear, and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from you, my land. I'm living on the mountain.
Make some room, we would appreciate that. And let's go ahead and begin the service with a word of prayer. Let's bow our heads together. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for allowing us to gather tonight. Thank you for this group that would come out this week. Lord, I pray you bless this service and bless every service this week. In your precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, let's take our song book. We're going to sing page number 210. I'm not preaching tonight, so I'd like to be able to at least lead music a little bit. So I'm going to sing this song with you. 210, Wonderful Grace of Jesus. Now, here's how this song works, all right? You see how when you get to the end there, to the chorus, you've got words on the bottom, wonderful, matchless grace of Jesus, and you got words on the top, matchless grace of Jesus. Here's how we do it at our church. The men sing that bottom line, and the women sing that top line, all right? So it's like men versus women, all right? Male versus ladies. So try to do the best you can. If you know it, let's sing it out. And if you don't know it, let's learn it together. 210, wonderful grace of Jesus. Now, on the first. Men are singing the bottom. Women are singing the top. Sing it out on the first.
Wonderful grace of Jesus.
Sing it out on the second. Make sure you can hear the ladies, a distinct women's part, a distinct men's part. Sing it out on the second.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, reaching to all the lost.
Preaching Conference, the verse theme this week, cry aloud, spare not, Lift up thy voice like a trumpet and show my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sin. Isaiah 58:1. You open up your bulletin there, you'll see a greeting from me and my wife, and I encourage you to read through that when you get a chance. We have the conference speakers this week. We have Pastor Steve Anderson is preaching tonight. Pastor Donnie Romero will be preaching tomorrow night. Pastor Burzis will be preaching on Saturday, and I'll be preaching on Sunday. I want to apologize about the heat. We didn't call it the Red Hot Preaching Conference for nothing, all right? And it's going to be hot whether you like it or not. But we're actually, tomorrow night, Lord willing, we'll rent another air conditioner. Maybe we'll be able to work those things out a little better. But we're not lukewarm, you know what I mean? So this is how it's going to be. But the baby room, we are a family integrated church. What that means is we keep the entire family together for the church service. We don't separate the children from their families for any reason. We have two mother baby rooms available for the ladies, a daddy room in the back for the men. I know the protesters are confused about this, but the pink signs are for the ladies, the blue signs are for the men, right? So just figure that out there. All of the rooms are comfortable seating. They have monitors set up. You can watch the service and listen to it. If you have a child that's being distracted during the service or if you need some privacy, we encourage you to get up and head back to those rooms as you need them. I'd like you to take a look at the conference schedule. You're here Thursday night. Pastor Anderson will be preaching tonight. And actually, we're going to have a 10-minute sermon before Pastor Anderson. We're going to have Evangelist Garrett Kirchway, who's a missionary coming out of Faithful Word, going to Botswana. He's going to preach to us for 10 minutes, all right? And then Pastor Anderson's going to come up and do the main sermon for tonight. And then on Friday morning, tomorrow morning, we have soul winning. If you want to come out soul winning, meet us here at the building at 9:30 a.m., all right? Make sure you're here at 9:30. And if you've never gone soul winning, it's a great opportunity for you to go. We'll partner you with someone who knows what they're doing, so that way you can be a silent partner, and it'll be a good time of fellowship on Friday morning. If you are a pastor's wife, and we have several pastor's wives at the conference, if you're a pastor's wife, we have a special pastor's wife high tea with my wife, Ms. Joanne Jimenez, at 1:30. Now, it's at 1:30 in Roseville, which is about 20 minutes from here. So if you could meet here, your pastor's wife, make sure you're here no later than 1 p.m. You'll be loading up and going to a special high tea with Ms. Jimenez. And then I'm having a special lunch for the pastors. If you're a pastor here, not just a speaker, just any pastor here for the conference, we have a special lunch for you tomorrow and for your kids, all right? The kids are with the men. All right, the women are going and having a nice time without the children. So your children and the men are here. Just meet us here at 1, and we'll get you situated for lunch. Tomorrow night, the evening service starts at 7 p.m. We'll have Pastor Romero be the main speaker. We may have a 10-minute sermon that night as well. Saturday morning, church by Sunday again, 9:30. At noon on Saturday, we have a lunch for all of the soul winners. All right? So if you go soul winning on Saturday morning, you can come here for lunch. We'll have lunch for you. Now, don't show up for lunch and you didn't go soul winning, all right? It's called the soul winner's lunch, so you got to at least go soul winning. And we want you to go. Please go. And if you sneak in here, don't worry. We won't kick you out. But at noon, we have the soul winner's lunch. Then we'll have an afternoon sermon on Saturday. No evening service on Saturday. The service will be at 2 p.m. We'll have a 10-minute sermon as well. Pastor Burzins will be the main speaker for that. Then at 5 p.m., we have a youth activity. Any teenagers who want to go to a youth activity, they're welcome to go with their parents' permission. We have a singles activity. If you are here and you are single, here's how we are identifying singles for the activity. You're not married and you've never been married, all right? You're not married, you've never been married. The singles activity is for you. 5 p.m. Sunday, we have a regular schedule, coffee and donuts, morning preaching, afternoon soul winning. And then in the Sunday evening service, we're having a men's preaching night. So we're going to open it up for guys to preach 5-minute sermons. Any guy who wants to preach, we're not going to be able to get every guy in. But if you let us know that you want to preach, we're going to pull names out of a hat. And if you are the chosen one, then you'll get to come up and preach for 5 minutes on Sunday night. So here's what I need you to do. In your bulletin, you'll find a communication card. If you would take a moment to fill this card out. If you don't have a bulletin, but you want a card, raise your hand. Our ushers will bring you one. If you need a pen, just raise your hand, we'll bring you a pen, and here's what we need you to do. We need you to fill out as much information as you feel comfortable, even if you're from out of town, because we may do something like this in the future, and we'd like to have your information to be able to mail you about things that we may be doing, like a conference next year or something like that. So if you would fill out that information on the back, you can sign up for different things, like you're planning to attend the singles activity, you're planning to attend the teen activity, if you'd like to sign up for a short sermon, check all of that off. We're going to sing a song in a moment. When we're done singing, we're going to receive the offering. As the offering plate goes by, you can drop this card in the offering plate, or you can hand it to our ushers, which are the men in the matching coats in the back, or you can hand it to me after the service. So please take a moment to fill this card out. Want to have a record of your attendance, want to know that you're here. We have people here from Canada, New Zealand, all over the country. Want to have a record of you being here. Please take a moment to fill out the info on the back if you'd like to sign up for one of the activities. And there's one more thing I want to bring up. There's a spot there for information about baptism. If you are here and you need to be baptized, we want to baptize you this week, all right? And you need to be baptized, check that off, and we'll get that situated so we can baptize you. If you look at the back of the bulletin, you get some information about each one of the events, soul winning, soul winners lunch, youth activity, singles activity, men's preaching night. Ask me if you have any questions about any of that. And just one more thing, we have a gift for all of you. Now, I don't think we have enough for all of you, so we're going to give one to every family, but Pastor Anderson and Faithful Word made a special, what are those things called? I don't know what those things are called. A USB port. That was called USB port. There you go. And it's got highlights. It's got about 15 sermons from every preacher in the conference. I want to give this to you as a free gift tonight. So we're gonna sing a song. You should have the insert in your bulletin. Holy, holy, holy. While we sing this song, our ushers gonna pass this gift out. I want to give one per family. So make sure you grab one. Try not to grab two if there's husband and wife and things like that. We're going to sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Now, this is a slow song, but you can still sing it with passion, all right? So let's sing it together, Holy, 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 while the ushers pass out those gifts. Sing it out on the verse.
Holy, Holy, Holy.
Let's make sure those protesters can hear us.
Perfect in
and bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the privilege that it is to join together with like-minded believers. Lord, we pray that you bless this evening, bless the preaching, the testimonies, the offering, Lord. I pray you bless the gift and the giver. In your precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Asked me to give a testimony just real quickly tonight. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Al Chiapetta. I've been coming here for about 3 years, since 2013. And really my story was, I'd been going to a lay church, a church that wasn't fired up about hard preaching, a church that wasn't fired up about soul winning. And I was going soul winning. I had another friend who was faithful about going soul winning, but I was really struggling to stay fired up. I was really just doing things out of duty and finding it hard to stay encouraged in the ways of God and stay encouraged in soul winning. And in May of 2013, my friends Matthew Stuckey and Jeff Butler and another friend Jason Robinson had been visiting up here, and I decided to come up and meet with them. And through that week, I had come to a preaching night, and then I also come soul winning. And the week really revolutionized my life. And I realized the importance of being in a good church. I realized just sitting through that preaching night and being part of that soul winning meeting, the importance of being near like-minded believers who are fired you up, who are fired up and will get you fired up. And at the time, I lived in the Bay Area, around 2 hours away. And I found myself, after this week, visiting more and more often. I found that being around the heart preaching and being around like-minded believers who were fired up about soul winning really made it a lot easier to be encouraged in the Christian life. Really made it a lot easier to be fired up. And I just found myself visiting more and more often until August 2013, I decided just to make the switch and transfer my membership to this church. So I found myself every Sunday driving around 2 hours each way. And many people at the time, they were shocked at the fact that I would drive 2 hours just to go to church. You know, aren't there churches that are closer to you? You know, don't you realize that the gas prices are up? Don't you realize all the wear and tear that's going to happen to your car? You know what? None of those things really matter to you. Because, you know, what mattered was my spiritual health. And the fact that I was fired up, and the fact that it was a lot easier for me to stay fired up, and to stay encouraging someone, to stay encouraging reading my Bible, that was too important for me. And it was crucial for me to set myself up in an environment that was conducive to my success. And so, I found myself just for 2 years
driving about 2 hours each way. And I would really want to use that that testimony of mine as an encouragement to anybody here who lives maybe 1 or 2 hours away from a great church, whether it be in Arizona or Texas or California. To any of you who live near a great church but find, I can make it, it's a bit of a commute, but, it's definitely something I can make, it's a little comfortable. Make the drive. Make the investment. You'll be glad after a few years that you did it. You'll be glad that you weren't one of these people who became washed up, or just became discouraged in your mind, and just said, quit. You'll be glad that you surrounded yourself with like-minded believers. So I would encourage you, make the drive, make the sacrifices necessary, and you know what? God may just bless you with the opportunity to move closer to church. That's actually what happened to me last year. I was actually blessed with the opportunity to come up, move to Sacramento. Now I live 7 minutes away from church. But I think God wouldn't have blessed me with the opportunity to be up here if I hadn't made the drive. So for any of you who have been toying with the idea of, making a long commute to make that extra investment to go to a great church, I would say from my experience, it's one of the best ideas.
Definitely do it. Thank you. Amen. 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 Let's go to Proverbs chapter 20. Good evening. My name is Derek Kirchhoy. I'm with Faithward Baptist Church. I'm planning on being a missionary to Botswana, Africa, leaving in 7 weeks. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, the title of this message is Wines on the Lees, Well Refined. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, the Bible reads, Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging. Whoso is deceived thereby is not wise. So I pray, dear God, I thank you for this opportunity to preach your word, Lord. I pray your spirit be upon me, Lord. And Lord, I pray be understandable. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The Bible speaks very strongly against alcohol. Proverbs chapter 20 says that wine is a mocker. Proverbs chapter 20 says that strong drink is raging. Proverbs chapter 20 says that whoso is deceived thereby is not wise. Deuteronomy 32 says that wine is a poison of dragons. Deuteronomy 32 says that wine is a cruel venom of ass. Deuteronomy 32 says that wine is a vine of Sodom and the field of Gomorrah. Proverbs 23 says that wine causes woe. Proverbs 23 says that wine causes contention. Proverbs 23 says, look not thou upon the wine when it is red. Proverbs 31 says, not for kings to drink wine. Proverbs 31 says, not for princes to drink strong drink. Proverbs 31 says, do we pervert the law when we drink wine? Numbers 28 says that wine is for the burnt offering. Numbers 28 says that we are poured out the wine before the Lord. The Bible speaks very strongly that wine represents a wrath of God, which is poured without mixture. Yeah. Hannah, the Bible says that wine is for the sons of Belial. Hannah, the Bible says that wine is for the sons of the devil. Hannah, the Bible says wine is not for those who pour out their soul before the Lord. Amen. Ham used wine to humiliate his father. Yeah. Belteshazzar used wine to humiliate his neighbor. Lot's daughters used wine to humiliate their father. Lot. The Bible speaks very strongly against alcohol. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 25. Not only does the Bible speak strongly against alcohol, but it speaks strongly that wine can be juice as well. Isaiah 65 calls it the new wine. Isaiah 65 says it's found in the cluster. Isaiah 65 says destroy it not, for there's a blessing in it. Song of Solomon calls it juice. Song of Solomon calls it spiced wine. Song of Solomon calls it the juice from the pomegranate from my mother's house. Genesis chapter 40 says that the chief butler pressed grapes. Genesis chapter 40 says he pressed them out of his hand. Genesis chapter 40 says he pressed grapes into Pharaoh's cup. The first word of wine press is wine. The second word of wine press is press. The wine press is used to press grapes into juice. Ziba gave David a bottle of wine. Ziba gave David's man a bottle of wine. Ziba gave David's man and whoever such be faith in the wilderness. Nehemiah had fresh meat prepared for him every day. Nehemiah had fresh juice prepared for him every
10 days. Nehemiah's men drink juice, not wine. Jesus said he would not drink the fruit of the vine till kingdom come. Jesus said he would not drink of the Father's vine till his kingdom come. Jesus said he would not partake of the fruit of the vine till the Father's kingdom is come. The Bible speaks very strongly that wine can be juice as well. Now, speaking about the great feast when the Father's kingdom has come, Isaiah 25:6 talks about that feast. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things, a feast of wines on the lees, of fat things full of marrow, of wines on the lees well refined. A number of people have asked me about this verse and asked me, saying, does this mean that Jesus is going to serve his alcohol when the Father's kingdom has come, or is he going to serve his juice? Let's go ahead and take a closer look at this. And in this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people of fat things. The word fat or fatness occurs 134 times in the Bible. But the definition for fat is abundance or plentiness or excess. If someone's fat, they got abundance. They got plentiness or they got excess. For the fatness of the land is the abundance of the land. For the plentiness of the land. For the excess of the land. Let's go to the second phrase. A feast of wines on the lees. Notice he says wines, plural, on the lees. He's not saying lees of the juice, which is basically the pulp. He's not saying lees of the wine, which is basically the sediment. But he says wines on the lees. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 38. What does it mean to be on the lees? The phrase on the lees occurs four times in the Bible, two times in Isaiah chapter 25, one time in Jeremiah 48, and one time in Zephaniah chapter 1. The context of Jeremiah 48 is this is judgment, God's judgment against Moab. One of his criticisms against Moab is they were settled on their lees, or they're resting upon their works and their treasures. Jeremiah chapter 48 verse 11 speaks, Moab has been at ease from his youth, and he has settled on his lees and have not been emptied from vessel to vessel. A parallel verse is verse 7, where he says, for because thou hast trusted in thy works and in thy treasures. So when you're settled on your lees, you're trusting in your works and your treasures. Go back to Isaiah 25. Zephaniah chapter 1 is a very similar judgment, but it's against Judah. God is criticizing them for being settled on their lees, or they're trusting in their silver and their gold. So a good definition for on the lees is on the abundance of, or the wealth of. So when we look at that second phrase, a feast of wines on the lees, means he's going to give us a feast of juices on the abundance of the land, or the wealth of the land. Let's go to the third phrase, a fat things full of marrow. The word marrow occurs five times in the Bible. Three of the times it means fullness of, or substance of. The other two times it literally means bone marrow. What's the bone marrow? The substance of the bone, or the fullness of the bone. So basically we have three very similar words or phrases. We have fat or fatness, which means abundance or excess or plentiness. We have on the lees, which means on the abundance of, or on the wealth of. And we have marrow, which is fullness or substance. So let's go through those four parallel statements. In this mountain shall the Lord of hosts make unto all people a feast of fat things or abundant things, a feast of wines on the lees or juices on the wealth of the land or abundance of the land, of fat things full of marrow or substance, of wines on the lees well refined. And so you ask, why are you saying that he's going to give us juice on the abundance of the land or juice on the wealth of the land? Well, first of all, the Bible speaks very strongly against alcohol. Like, don't even look at it.
Right.
Secondly, Jesus said, calls it the fruit of the vine three times. And number three, this fourth phrase. Let's look at the fourth phrase. A wine on the lees, well refined. What does well refined mean? Pure. Pure. See, the word refined, tried, and purified are used interchangeably in the Bible. So when something's well refined, it's pure. That makes sense. See, a good juice is pure fruit. A good alcoholic wine is not pure fruit. A good alcoholic wine is tainted fruit. Basically, you take most or all the sugar of the juice and you turn it to poison. That's not well refined at all. That's not pure at all. So when he calls it wine on the lees while refined, he's calling it that pure juice on the abundance of the land or the wealth of the land. So you say, why am I preaching this? Well, I'm planning on being a missionary in Botswana. Botswana is in the southern region of Africa. It's about the size of Texas. It has about 2 million people in it. Botswana is considered a Christian nation. It's, although nobody seems to be preaching the gospel there, it's dominated by the Pentecostal churches, the Protestant churches, and the Catholic Church has a presence there as well. Most of the church service, a good missionary must be a soul winner, must be a recruiter, and must be a teacher. And when you teach, you need to teach against the sins of the land.
Right. Amen.
Alcohol is a big sin in Africa. It's actually reached to the house of the president. The president of the country actually issued a 70% tax levy or tax increase on all alcohol products in the nation. And he's warning the people, saying, if you don't cut down your consumption, I'm going to add another 70% on top of that. Why is alcohol so popular there? Well, first of all, it's in the churches. The reason why it's in the churches is there's a lot of confusion in that people see about alcohol. There's a lot of false teachings about alcohol. Also, their Bibles are messed up. Believe it or not, John chapter 2 in many of their versions says that Jesus turned water into alcohol. Not water into wine, but water into alcohol. We need to get the King James Version to as many people as we can. We need to translate the Bible into the King James Version, into their own motherland. We need to preach hard against sin. We're actually opening up a Baptist church in Haveroni, which is the capital city. We're going to open it up September 25th. Pastor Anderson is going to conduct the first two services. I'll take over the 28th. We're going to preach hard against all the sins of the land. I can't guarantee we're going to bring down the alcohol consumption in the country of Botswana, that I can bring it down in our church. Yeah. When we preach the King James Bible, when we preach hard, if they still don't listen up, we'll kick them out of church. Like 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11. And if the other churches follow suit, maybe the alcohol consumption will come down and the president will be happy. The title of this message is Wines on the Lees, Well Refined. Number one, the Bible speaks very strongly against alcohol. Number two, the Bible speaks strongly that wine can be juiced. And number three, Wines on the Lees, Well Refined means that Jesus is going to serve as pure fruit juice.
Amen.
From the abundance of the land or the wealth of the land. Whether you're from America or from Botswana. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear God, I thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. I thank you, God, for this assembly, Lord. Pray that your spirit be upon Pastor Anderson, Lord. Our ears be open and ready to hear. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Said unto them, when it is evening, ye say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red.
And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the times? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. And he left them and departed. And when his disciples were come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread. Then Jesus said unto them, Take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, It is because we have taken no bread. Which, when Jesus perceived, he said unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves, because ye have brought no bread? Do ye not yet understand, neither remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000, and how many baskets ye took up? Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000, and how many baskets ye took up? How is it that ye do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees? Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea of Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, Whom do men say that the Son of Man am? And they said, Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets. He saith unto them, But whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevent against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. From that time forth began Jesus priests and scribes, and be killed, and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there shall some be standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Let us pray. Almighty Father, thank you for this opportunity to come here tonight to hear your word be preached. Please bless the message. Please let it bring glory to you. Please open our hearts. Please open our ears to your message and help us keep distractions to a minimum. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Man, it's great to be here tonight. Thank you everyone who came out. And I just want to say before I get started preaching that there is a bunch of stuff out there in the lobby, audio CDs, USB flash drives. All right, and also DVDs of a film that we put together recently called Professing Themselves to Be Wise, and we brought a few hundred DVDs, so it should be plenty for you to grab 1, 2, 3, whatever you want to do with that. And it's got a wonderful picture on the back of me with the Dr. Spergel glasses with the taped up and everything like that. I was out soul winning the other day, and I gave it to a guy that we had just won to the Lord. And he said, Oh, is this a picture of you back in the day? And I was like, No, I was never that geeky, you know. It was just a joke. But anyway, yeah, be sure to grab that stuff. It's all free. Load up on it. Make sure it all goes to a good home. Give it away. Use it. Don't enshrine it. But Matthew chapter number 16 is where I want to start tonight. The title of this sermon is The Signs of the Times. The Signs of the Times. Starting in verse number 1, the Bible reads, The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came, and tempting, desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven. He answered and said unto them, When it is evening, ye say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but can ye not discern the signs of the times? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. And there shall no sign be given unto it but the sign of the prophet Jonas.
and he left them and departed. Now, if you would turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, of course, follows up the famous passage on the rapture at the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. One of the most common scriptures quoted in a Baptist church, one of the most famous scriptures of all time, is that scripture at the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. But not a lot of people follow it up with reading into chapter 5 and getting more of the context, where Jesus and his second coming are said to be as a thief in the night only to the unsaved. But he says that we that are saved are not in darkness, that that day should overtake us as a thief. We are not going to be taken by surprise because we have the Bible telling us all the things that will lead up to it. And we can see the signs of the times. That's why he says in verse number 1 of 1 Thessalonians 5, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. You don't need me to tell you. You already know, he's saying. You yourselves perfectly know, verse 2, that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. Ye are all the children of light, and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Let us watch. We don't have to be in the dark tonight. We have the Word of God to tell us about the events of the end times. We know the sequence of events. We know what things will be like when the end is approaching. We can read it in the Bible, and then if we have our eyes open, we can discern the signs of the times that we're living in. I submit to you that if we look around today, we can see many signs that we are living in the last days. No man knoweth the day or the hour of Christ's second coming. I don't pretend to know when it's going to be. It could be a few years from now. It could be a few decades from now. I have no idea, but I'll tell you this right now. There are many things that we see today that would indicate to us that we are rapidly approaching the end. We can discern the signs of the times of God's people. Go, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter number 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3, there are many scriptures in the New Testament that talk about what things are going to be like in the last days, that describe the world shortly before Christ's second coming. And we see a lot of those things happening all around us. You know, even if we were to just look at the technology, we can see now that the technology is in place where the scriptures in the book of Revelation could literally be fulfilled. Many people in the past looked at things in the book of Revelation and they thought a lot of it was figurative, that was actually literal, because they thought to themselves, this would be impossible. For example, if a few hundred years ago, you're reading a scripture that talks about how no man is going to be able to buy or sell without a mark in his right hand or in his forehead, you'd say to yourself, how could that be? There's always going to be a black market. There could always be people that would just pay with cash and that would use silver and gold and coins and paper money. And there's already a great black market. They can't really stop people from buying or selling. But now in 2016, we see the technology in place for a cashless society. A cashless society. And the wallet that you have filled with paper money is only worth anything because people have agreed that it's worth something. And as soon as the government were to say at the end of this year, you know, December 31st, whatever the year, that money is going to be no good anymore. You need to turn that into the bank and it'll go in your electronic account. Then that paper money would be worthless at that point. And we're getting to the point now where you can see the transition is very possible to a society with no cash, where every transaction is electronic. And look how easy it was for them to shut down our PayPal accounts as soon as we started preaching things that they didn't like. And obviously that's not, you know, the tribulation, but it just shows you how that's where things are going. You preach the Word of God, you don't get on board, we'll shut down your account. Now thank God to do online banking through and online transactions. But what when it's all integrated and they just push a button and your account is frozen, your account is seized? We can see how that's possible.
The technology's there. It's not far-fetched at all. Then you look at scriptures, for example, in Revelation chapter 11, where it refers to the two witnesses and how they'll be killed and their dead bodies will lie in the streets of Jerusalem for 3 days. And it says the whole world will see their dead bodies lying in the street. A couple hundred years ago, you'd wonder, how could the whole world see these guys if they're in Jerusalem? But of course, now we have the internet and satellite TV and cameras. And so you can see how it would be broadcast live to the entire world. And the technology is in place for these things to be fulfilled, quite literally. We could be approaching the end. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, a description of the end times, it says, "This know also, that in the last days..." Hey, children, sit still. 2 Timothy 3:1, "This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come." Perilous means dangerous. He says, "For men shall be lovers of their own self." One of the things that characterizes the end times is that people would be self-centered, self-absorbed, lovers of their own self. And we see that in this generation more than any other generation. This overly sensitive, just worried about themselves. Everything's about me. You know, people have called it Generation Me. Generation Selfie. Generation Selfie Stick. Generation Everybody, it's all about me. I mean, think about the fact that as our society becomes more sinful, it becomes more selfish. I mean, what could be more selfish when you think about major big sins? Sins like murder and adultery. What could be more selfish than murdering your own child for your own convenience? Yeah. Yeah. That's exactly what abortion is. Yeah. You're so concerned with yourself that you're willing to murder an innocent baby just so that you can have a different quality of life. That's total selfishness. You think about how selfish it would be for you to cheat on your spouse, to commit adultery with another man or commit adultery with another woman, and to bring that pain and suffering upon your spouse, upon your husband and your wife. I mean, what a selfish thing to do. Sin is selfish. That's why the Bible says that all the law is fulfilled in this one word: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. He said, look, if you love your neighbor, you're not going to kill your neighbor. You're not going to commit adultery with your neighbor. You're not going to steal from your neighbor. You're not going to lie to your neighbor. You know, sin at its core is self-centered, selfish, self-absorbed. And we're living in a day where men are lovers of their own selves. Where people, when they choose a church, they just want to know what that church can do for them. What kind of programs do you have for me? What kind of programs do you have for the children? They don't stop and ask themselves, hey, is this a team I want to be a part of? Is this a place where I want to go and work and serve God? Serving in the local church, working in the local church. You know, we have a room at the back of our church. Well, now it's actually off to the side. But it's a room that has like a refrigerator. You know, most churches have some kind of a kitchen or some kind of a place with refrigerators or tables. You know, at our church, I call it the break room. And the reason I call it the break room is because I consider the church a place of business, a place of work, a place where people are doing work. And they go in there to take a break from the work that they're doing. It's like a job. You know, they go and they win souls and preach and serve and both their things and get involved. It's not a place where you go like a theater and just sit down and enjoy the show and then walk out. No, no. It's a place of work. But lovers of their own selves don't understand that. They just want to come and have their itching ears tingled. They want the sermon to feed them. And they just want to feed and feed and feed when they need to get out there and work for the Lord. That's why we have a break room at our church. You say, ah, I can't believe you say business. Well, you know what? Jesus said I must be about my Father's business. You know what the first four letters of business are? Busy. Busy. And only communists and hippies don't like the word business.
Amen. Amen.
Now look what the Bible says here in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. It says, "This know also." Of their own self. Why? Because those are dangerous people. People who just only love and care about themselves. they'll kill you. Just absorbed in loving themselves is going to create a dangerous environment for others. They're going to grow up and be a criminal. Children who are never taught to think about the needs and the feelings of others and empathize with others. The Bible says men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, meaning that they desire that which doesn't belong to them. They lust after more money and more things and more possessions. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. It says they're covetous, they're boasters, meaning that they brag and talk about how great they are, which again goes along with being a lover of your own self when you're a braggart and a boaster. Proud. Again, that goes right hand in hand. Blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. These are the type of things that we're seeing abound in our culture in America today. People are disobedient to their parents. They're blasphemous. They're boasters. They're proud. They blow off their mouth against God and against the Bible and against His anointed. And they have no fear of God today. The Bible says they're without natural affection. Truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce. And then look at this last one. Despisers of those that are good. We're living in a day where the wicked despise those that are good. And now it's even getting to the point where even mainstream America is starting to despise those that are good. Now what's interesting about the word despise is that it pretty much means hate. I mean, if I said I despise something or despise someone, that would mean that I hate that person or hate that thing. Despiteful or despising, these are synonyms for hating. And what's interesting today is that these bunch of freaks and perverts out there, for example, that are protesting this event, they are despisers of those that are good. And you know what? These people from the media here,
come on.
I mean, unless they turn over a new leaf and start telling the truth, which probably isn't very likely. But these bozos from the media over here, they're going to show all the love wins and love conquers hate. They won't show you how God-fearing family men and women walk in this church, and women are called a slut and a whore, and they've never even seen these women in their life because they just rail and hate and spew out all their filth. And they're disgusting, but you won't show that on the media, will you? No, you'll show all the little, pretty little sodomites, and they all love each other. Why don't you go to AIDS.gov and show what these people are really like, where they're 50 times more likely to get AIDS. Why don't you do a story on how homosexuals are 50 times more likely to get AIDS? Why don't you go to CDC.gov? Because you're a coward, that's why. Hey, by the way, learn how to count. Go back to school and learn how to count. This isn't 75 people. You want to make it out like it's just a few people. Hey, there's still 7,000 men in this country who have the God to be a baby. The Bible says, despisers of those that are good. Every single one of these homos would love to tear me apart limb from limb. If they could get in here and the police wouldn't stop them, they'd love to come in here and rip us apart and kill us all. And they don't just hate me. They don't just hate Brother Jimenez. They hate all Christians. And they would love to destroy us all. You know that's right, and yet they say that we're hateful. Well, you know what? At least I admit that I do hate pedophiles and perverts. But these people are hypocrites. They won't admit it, but they hate my ever-loving guts. Let's continue with this passage. It says in verse number 4, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. You know, this is the people who don't have time for church because they're too busy out having a good time. They're out playing and they're going to the lake and they're coming out. And look, I love going to the lake, but you know what? I'm not going to go to the lake when I ought to be in church. Because I don't love pleasure more than I love God. And the Bible says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof,
from such turn away. You see, there are all kinds of churches around Sacramento and across our nation. They have a form of godliness. They have a form of Christianity. They have a form of biblical teaching. But they deny the power thereof. You know what the power thereof means? It means the authority thereof. It means the might and the strength behind it. You see, there are churches out there that claim to be a Christian church, but they'll even deny the miracles of the Bible. They'll say that the children of Israel didn't really part the cross on the Red Sea after Moses parted it through the power of God. They'll say that it was just a land bridge, or it was the wind that did it, or it was just some kind of a reed sea instead of the Red Sea. They'll claim that Jesus was not born of a virgin. They'll claim that Jesus didn't walk on water. And they teach a social gospel, and they have a fake Christianity. I'm talking about the United Methodists tonight. Let's call it what it is. United Methodists, they'll sit there and deny the virgin birth, deny the bodily resurrection of Christ. They have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of God. They don't believe in the miracles of the Bible. Not only that, but they deny the power of God's word. They believe that their views and their understanding trump God's word. No, God's word has the power. God's word has the authority. God's word is what we ought to go to, not to whatever's popular or whatever the opinion of the month is that the media is cramming down our throat.
Amen.
So what we see in this passage, if we were to take the whole thing in aggregate, and obviously we don't have time to talk about each point on the list, is that in the last days, when he lists all these sins, he's saying the last days are going to be very sinful days. If we were to just sum it up in one sentence, we'd say in the last days, perilous times will come because sin will abound. There's going to be a very sinful, and what do we see? We see our country is more sinful than it was 10 years ago. It's more sinful than it was 30 years ago. We can see clearly that the morality in our country is going down. And it was going down like this, but in the last 3-4 years, it seems like it's just on a bobsled to hell. That's what we see today. Now, if you would, turn to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter number 17. Luke chapter 17, we're talking about the signs of the times. Jesus Christ said that his second coming would not catch us unawares. It would not come upon us as a thief in the night, because we can look around and see these things begin to come to pass. We see a world government forming.
That's right.
The United Nations.
Yeah.
We see the United States relinquishing its sovereignty to this world body. The last time the United States declared war on anyone was when they declared war on the country of Hungary in World War II.
Yeah.
Ever since then, we're just enforcing United Nations resolutions. The last declaration of war from the Congress of the United States was World War II. But have we fought war since then?
Yep.
With no declaration of war, because we're going under the authority of the United Nations. We are seeing a world government forming. That's a sign of the times. When we see the stage being set for, as the Bible says, all nations, all tongues, all kindreds, and all people to look to one leader, the Antichrist.
Yeah.
To worship one man, the Antichrist. That's why we see all of the religions coming together.
Yeah.
We see the Catholics and the Protestants coming together and saying that the Protestant Reformation was just a big misunderstanding. Just a big mix-up. And finally, we can clear it up 400 years later. What are we thinking? We all believe the same things. That's what they're saying today in the news. We see today that Eastern mysticism is even coming into the church. And we see that the Buddhists and the Hindus and the coexist mentality, where all religions come together. We can see the New Age movement today rolling out and becoming mainstream doctrine in the United States of America. Universalism, universalist religion that says, well, Christianity is a way. Jesus said, I'm the way.
Amen.
And they say, oh, well, you know, that's a way, but Islam has a way, and Hinduism has a way, and they're following the light that they have, and we're following the light. No, no, no. There's only one light, and it's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ is the only way to be saved. It's the only way to heaven. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And at the second coming of Christ, the Bible says in Luke chapter 16, verse 26, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. At the second coming of Christ, the Bible teaches that in the days leading up to that, it will be like it was in the days of Noah, and it will be like it was in the days of Lot. This passage in Luke 17 contains the famous scriptures about the rapture, where it talks about two being in the field, one taken and the other left, two women grinding at the mill, one taken, the other left. That passage about the rapture in context is compared to the days of Noah when the flood came and destroyed them all, and the days of Lot when fire and brimstone rained down from heaven and destroyed the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. This is referring to the fact that the day that the rapture takes place, it will rain fire and brimstone upon the earth, according to the Bible, which of course takes place after the tribulation, but before God's wrath is poured out. And all God's people said,
amen.
Whoa, no pre-trippers here tonight, huh? If so, don't say anything. But anyway, somebody will be glad to explain it to you after the service. But in Luke 17, he compares it to the days of Lot for a reason.
Yeah.
It's funny, when I was growing up, my dad's here tonight, he used to always say, I don't think the end is yet, he said, because it's not like it was in Sodom yet. And I remember thinking to myself, I don't think he's right about that. Because I read the story of Sodom, and I said, it's never going to be like that. So I thought, he's misinterpreting that. But you know what, Dad? You were right. Because you know what? It's starting to look like the days of Lot out there. I mean, I got off the airplane in Sacramento. I thought, it seemed like San Francisco. I got off the airplane in Sacramento, California this morning, and it was 2 minutes before I saw a dude walking through the airport with a skirt on. I mean, we're living in days that are getting to be like it was in the days of Lot. And you know what I think is so funny? Is when people attack us, Bible-believing preachers, and they say, oh, why do you preach about homosexuality so much? Why do you keep bringing that up? Why are you so fixated on that? Why are you bringing it up? Hey, because it's being crammed down our throat every stupid day. Because not a day goes by that the TV and the magazines and the newspapers aren't cramming this trash down our throat. And you know what? We didn't pick this fight. The fight came to us. And you know what? I didn't write this book. And this book already predicted thousands of years ago that that's what would be happening. I mean, I didn't choose that, hey, in the end times, before the second coming of Christ, we're going to have to be ripping face about a bunch of perverts and homos, and that's going to be the big issue in America that everybody talks about every single day in America. Hey, I didn't choose that. I didn't even predict that. I thought my dad was wrong about that, okay? I didn't choose this fight. This fight has come to us, and you know what I say? Bring it on!
Bring it on!
Whatever fight the devil wants to bring me, bring it on. Because
yeah.
I'll preach any part of the Bible, and I'm not ashamed of any of it. I like all of it. But we didn't choose this.
Well, why do you make that your battle?
I didn't make that my battle. I preach 156 sermons a year. I preach every book of the Bible. I preach out of Genesis. I preach out of Exodus. I preach out of Leviticus. I preach out of Numbers. I preach out of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. I preach on the gospel. I preach on heaven. I preach on hell. I preach on the deity of Christ. I preach on the Trinity. I preach on salvation by faith. I preach on the eternal security of the believer. I'm preaching on repentance. I'm preaching on this. I'm preaching on that. And then you preach on sodomy and all the cameras show up. I didn't choose that. They chose it because this fits their agenda. But you know what? They don't realize. They come in here because it fits their agenda, their little narrative, their brainwashing campaign that they're a part of, whether they know it or not or believe it or not.
That's right.
You know why they're here? They're here because their bosses want them here.
Amen.
And they're here to demonize Christianity. They're here to demonize God's people. But you know what? You can't even make us look. Take me out of context all you want. Because you know what? The stuff I say from the Bible is so true, even out of context, I still like it. I still like it. I mean, even the TV pieces where they attack me, and can you believe, look, I'm watching all your guys' coverage the past 30 minutes, I got popcorn, and I'm thinking, man, he looks good on there. Yeah! Hell! But these people in the media, they're so deluded, they think like, oh man, when we put this on TV, man, everybody's going to hate Pastor Jimenez. You know what they don't realize, Brother Jimenez, is that half the people in Sacramento are sitting at home, and they're seeing you on TV, and they're saying, hey, there's a guy with some guts. There's a guy who's finally telling it like it is. There's a guy that actually believes the Bible. And you know what? They just don't have the guts to say it. But they're sitting there at home, in the comfort of their home, saying, it's about time somebody told it like it is. So all the media is doing is just helping get the word of God out. And you know what? The Apostle Paul talked about how some people were spreading the word of God for the wrong motives. You know, he said, they preach Christ even of envy and strife. They preach it of contention, trying to add affliction to our bonds, you know, trying to add persecution to us. But you know what? Hey, I just rejoice that people are hearing about Verity Baptist Church. Great! Because then they're going to tune in, and they're going to get the gospel. They're going to get the soul winning. They're going to get everything else he preaches 95% of the time when he's not talking about perverts. All the other good stuff from the Bible, they're going to tune in, and then, you know, some of these cowards, once they see him go through the storm, once they see him stand tall, see, a lot of people are sitting at home right now just wanting to see how it's all going to turn out. They want, look, nobody wants to get on board with a loser, with a quitter. Now, I know you're not a loser, I know you're not a quitter, but they're sitting back and they're watching, and let me tell you something, he's going to be like a rock, because he's founded on the rock. And I'm going to tell you something. When the battle's over, when the dust settles, and when the media's moved on to their next faggot-promoting story that they want to write, their next wicked, godless story to promote the downfall of morality in America, and when they go back to printing more smut and crap in their stupid newspaper and their stupid TV show and television, you know what? He's going to still be standing, and this church will just grow and grow and grow. And you know what? I already know it. Hey, I've already been doing it. I went through this in Phoenix, Arizona 7 years ago, and you know what? Our church is bursting at the seams. We just can't knock out the walls fast enough to expand our auditorium. Because you know what? People want truth. Bible says in Daniel chapter 12, go to Daniel chapter 12. We're going to look at some things from Daniel. Let's go back to the Old Testament. Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter number 12. We're going to look at some things from Daniel chapter 12 and Daniel 11. These are two scriptures that have to do with the end times, that have to do with the second coming of Jesus Christ, where Daniel is actually seeing things way into the future. In fact, in Daniel chapter 12, he's told, we'll seal up these things because these things are not going to happen for a really long time. We're living in those times where we're getting close to the fulfillment of these things. Let's see some things that characterize the end times leading up to the second coming of Christ. Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, the Bible reads, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation even to that same time. That's referring to the tribulation. In Matthew 24, he used almost the same wording. Then shall be great tribulation, such as never was since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be. If you look at the word trouble and you look at the word tribulation, you'll notice that the consonants are the same. T-R-B-L, right? Trouble, tribulation. These are related words. He says, at that time, thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness, and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. One of the things that God points to as coming shortly before the end is that many would run to and fro, and that knowledge would be increased. Go back to Daniel chapter number 11. Many would run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Now that is something that we're seeing happen very rapidly today. I believe when the Bible says many shall run to and fro and knowledge shall be increased, that has to do with the technology that we see,
right,
where transportation is so much faster, where people can just run to and fro. I mean, we have people here tonight at this service from a whole bunch of foreign countries. I know my friend here, Rob from Canada. Where's Nar? From Canada, right? And then we got Brother Logan Robinson from New Zealand. Who else is here from a foreign country tonight? Anybody else from a foreign country? Yes. Where are you from?
New Zealand.
New Zealand also.
Canada with Rob.
Canada with Rob. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah. Australia, all right. Anybody else from a foreign country? Canada. Yeah, Kazakhstan, all right. You know, that just shows you the amazing transportation where people can just hop on a plane and come here from Kazakhstan, Australia, New Zealand, different parts of Canada, and be in a place like this. Why? Because the technology is facilitating that, and then he says knowledge shall be increased. You know, one of the most amazing things about the technology that we have today in 2016 is the way that we can just get information on the internet. I mean, I remember when I was even a child, if you wanted to learn about something, if you wanted to know some piece of information, you had to take a trip down to the library and you'd pull books off the shelf that were 20 years old or 10 years old, and you're trying to get up-to-date information. Sometimes you had to travel to distant cities to access larger libraries and find the data, find the information. I mean, we can just be walking around and see some plant or some animal now. All we have to do, hey, what kind of plant is that? Just take a picture of it on your phone. There's an app that'll tell you what kind of plant it is. Hey, what was the name of that? Oh, everything. Any question you have, any piece of information you want to know, anything you want to learn about, it's just so simple. You just Google it. All that information is at our fingertips. Obviously, there are a lot of bad things that are also available on the internet. There are a lot of people that would use it for, you know, pornography, or use it for online gambling, or use it for adultery or other nefarious purposes. But one of the things that the internet has done is it has allowed us to preach the Word of God to a mass audience. We don't need the media anymore. That's why they already walked out, you know. We don't need them anymore. We don't have to, nobody listens to them anymore. That's why the Sacramento Bee keeps getting thinner every year. Nobody cares. And we are living in a very special time because we can actually be the media. YouTube, me too. I mean, we can actually broadcast the truth and get millions of viewers. Let me tell you something. The internet is the printing press of the 21st century.
Amen.
I mean, it's the most revolutionary thing since the invention of the printing press, and we can actually upload true biblical preaching. I mean, in the past, to be a TV preacher, you have to be a total compromiser. You have to be bought and paid for by the devil to get on TV. Now anybody can upload sermons. Brother Jimenez, myself, other men of God all over the world preaching the truth can upload it and have access to millions of viewers. It's amazing. And so many pastors are just, they're not even capitalizing on that opportunity. I mean, I guess if they were living back in the 1500s and the 1600s, they would forget the printing press. We're happy with our little church, us four no more. But I'm telling you, we have an opportunity to broadcast this stuff to the world in all languages and get it out there. Look, I don't know about you. I want to work hard, and I want to pull out all the stops because I don't know how long the party's going to last. I mean, when are they going to start censoring us on the internet or pull the plug on the internet? I don't know, but I'm going to put as much stuff on the internet as I can and get it out to as many millions of people as I can before that happens.
That's right.
And then we'll just switch to just flash drives. Yep, that's going to be next. Just flash drives, CDs, DVDs. Have fun collecting up all those and trying to censor us.
Right.
But look what the Bible says in Daniel 11. Go back a few verses to Daniel 11:32. It says, "And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits." Exploits are great works, legendary works, amazing works, epic works. He says, "They that be strong and do know their God," he says, "they'll be strong and they'll do exploits." Verse 33, "And they that understand among the people shall instruct many." They will instruct many. They'll be, they that understand, they that know the Bible, they that are preaching the truth, shall instruct many. I believe that in the end times, there will be one last great push where the gospel will go all around the globe and where people will hear the gospel like they've never heard it before in the last days. And look, it's not just through the power of the internet, it's going to be through door-to-door soul winning, because a lot of people don't ever go on the internet. But let me tell you something, we need to have a multi-pronged attack. We need to be out there physically, flesh and blood, knocking doors every week, up one street, down the other, every door in Sacramento, every door in Citrus Heights, every door in Elk Grove, every door in Roseville, every door in Orangevale, every door in Carmichael, every door in West Sac, every door downtown, every door in this whole area, physically, boots on the ground, knocking those doors, and then broadcasting to the whole world on the internet. But I talked to some pastors and they said, "Well, I agree with what you're preaching, but I've never put it on YouTube because I don't want the persecution." I guess you forgot that verse that told you to leap for joy when the persecution comes. I guess you forgot the part about whoso findeth his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. I guess you forgot that verse that said, "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but out of them all the Lord delivers him." And let me tell you something. With the doors being knocked and the soul-winning church is springing up all over America. And let me tell you something, it's starting to accelerate. We're seeing new churches start. We're starting, you know, 3 new churches this fall. Just what our church is doing. Let alone what Verity's going to be doing. Let alone what Steadfast is going to be doing. Let alone what Word of Truth does. Let alone what Old Path does. West City Bible Baptist. Whatever other churches that share the same vision of knocking every door and of preaching from the housetop all the counsel of God, uncensored, unadulterated, unfiltered, well-refined.
Amen.
Preach
Amen.
It.
Amen.
Brother Garrett Kersway, our missionary to Botswana, you know, he just indicated to me this afternoon, he said, "Hey, I've gotten you the opportunity while you're in Botswana, because I'm only going to be there for a week, to preach in a public school." He said, "You'll be preaching to hundreds and hundreds of junior hires." He's trying to get me into the high school in that village as well. I'll tell you what I want to do, Brother Garrett. I want to get a list of every high school and every junior high in the country of Botswana. We're going to work down that thing like a checklist, and we're going to preach the gospel in every single school that will let us, and we're going to keep calling them, and we're going to offer them free Bibles, free New Testaments, free DVDs, free CDs, a flash drive if you got a computer, and you know what? We'll come and preach the gospel, and we're going to do great works, God willing, through His strength, if He allows us to. We're going to continue doing the greatest works. Look, I want to do the greatest works that the world has ever seen. And I'm going to tell you something. It's not because I'm anything special, because you know what? He's doing the same thing. All these other pastors are doing the same thing. All the speakers you're going to hear from are all sharing the same vision. Look, it's not anything about me. Look, in 10 years, 20 years, there are going to be 100 of me. Yeah. And you're going to forget that I even exist because there's going to be 100 of me. Praise God.
Yeah.
I don't matter. All I am is a guy who just decided to get up and preach it like it is and let the chips fall where they may. And you young men here, you could be that guy.
Right, good.
I'm not talented. He's way more talented than I am. Brother Jimenez is a lot more talented than me. You know, when it took me about 500 times preaching before I preached like him, like on his third time. I'm not joking. I'm not kidding. You know what? Young man out there who's listening, you could be one of the hundreds. I believe that in my lifetime, there will be hundreds of preachers that are just like me, greater than me, doing better works than me, putting me to shame. Hey, that's what I believe God has told us will happen in the end time. He said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all nations, and then shall the end come. And I believe we're starting to see that happening. And you know what? It's a sign of the times.
Yes, sir.
It's a sign of the times that Sacramento is hearing the truth. Yeah. And you know what? Whether they hear or whether they forbear, whether they sit at home and, ah, how dare you, you know, offend the LGBT, HIV, ABCD, EFD community. You know, how dare you offend all these people? You know what? It doesn't matter. You know what's for sure? They'll know that a prophet has been among them.
Yes.
They'll know that a prophet has been among them.
Amen.
And I'm here to tell you that we are living in the last days. We don't know when it's going to be. But I don't know about you, I want to be one of the people that does great exploits. I want to be a part of it. And I want to be on the ground. I want to be just knocking doors one at a time. I want to be one of God's people that's a part of the team. I want to be a part of a church. I want to be a part of a movement.
Come on. Yeah, right.
That is not backing down and going, oh man, I mean, you know, they're taking over. We got to do something. We got to do something. I don't want to do something. I want to do the greatest thing that the world has ever seen. Get a vision tonight that's big. Do something big for God. And you know what? Every man, woman, boy, and girl can be a part of it. Well, I'm not talented. You know what? You don't have to be talented to be a soul winner. And if you're a consistent soul winner, you will be great in the kingdom of heaven, period. 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 You will be great if you bet. Look, it doesn't take any special talent. It doesn't take any special ability. You know what it takes? Guts.
That's right.
That's all it takes. That's all it takes. And you know what? Anybody who wants to can have guts, because the Bible says that if we pray for boldness, He will grant us boldness. Even the most shy and timid can become as fearless as a lion when they are filled with the Holy Spirit of God. That's what the Bible teaches. The Bible says, when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Man, woman, boy, and girl, we're all filled with the Holy Ghost. And you know what? You want to be filled with the Holy Ghost? You better be in the right place at the right time. Because they were all filled with the Holy Ghost because they were there. Which goes back to what Brother Al said about being in the right place, being in the right church, getting around God's people. The signs of the times are everywhere. Are you able to discern them? Are we living in days that are beginning to resemble the days of Lot before he went out of Sodom and Gomorrah? Are we beginning to live in days where people are exceedingly sinful and lovers of their own self? Do we see the technology? Do we see the police state in place? Do we see the world government forming? Do we see all of the things that the Bible told us would happen coming to pass right around us? And do we see a great fire and a great movement amongst God's people for a soul-winning revival unlike anything the world has ever seen? Why not? God's arm is not shortened that He cannot save. It's you and I that have the power to limit God by our lack of vision and our lack of faith. Or we can do the greatest works that the world has ever seen. But it's up to us. What are we going to do? Are we going to be ordinary? Are we going to be the usual run-of-the-mill Joe church member? Or are we going to rise up? Don't tell me about some greatest generation of some old. I don't want to hear about that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the greatest generation. How about 2016?
Amen.
God, how about the people that were winning to Christ in 2013, 14, 15? The spiritual babies that are born in 2012, 2013, 2014. You know what? I don't care what Dan Rather says, that or Tom Brokaw, whoever that was that put that thing together. Hey, when we get to heaven, the greatest generation is going to be the God's people.
Amen.
That did the most works for God and the most soul winning for God. And I pray that it would be the people that got saved in 2010. 2011, 2012. I pray there be a great baby boom of spiritual babies that are born. And that these spiritual babies would go out and rise up and be the greatest generation of Christians that literally would shake the world and would literally just, you write the book, you decide whether it's going to happen or not. I can't decide, because I can't do it by myself, so I can't make that decision. I can decide to be a part of it, but you have to decide to be a part of it too. And together, we can get the gospel to Sacramento like Sacramento has never seen it before.
Amen.
And the whole world. Now, I don't know the history of Sacramento. I don't know what kind of soul-winning churches have been here in the past. I'm not sure exactly what they accomplished, which doors they knocked. You know, if we were to be able to get in a time machine, go back to the 1960s or the 1970s, I don't know what kind of great soul-winning churches existed, but you know what? I believe the Verity Baptist Church can, and I believe that it will, by the grace of God, be the greatest soul-winning church in the history of this city.
Amen.
That ought to be the goal.
Yeah.
Go big or go home. Lift our eyes and have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your word, Lord, warning us and also guiding us through these perilous times, Lord. We are going into uncharted waters. Our nation is different than it has ever been before, Lord. And I pray that you would guide us and direct us through your word and that we would know how to behave ourselves in these times. Lord, many have been cowards. They've ducked out of the battle. Lord, but I pray that those that are here tonight would still be standing 6 months from now, 12 months from now, all the way until the trumpet sounds, Lord, I pray that I would be faithful, Lord. I also need prayer. We all need to stay strong until the bitter end, Lord. And help us to make it all the way to the end, Lord. Still faithful, still standing. And not only just surviving, but thriving. And doing the great exploits that you predicted in Daniel chapter 11. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Man, that was a wonderful, wonderful sermon. You know why we call it the Red Hot Preaching Conference? That's good. Pastor Anderson, thank you very much. All week long, all right? Make sure you're here tomorrow night. And Pastor Romero's going to be preaching. I know Pastor Romero, he's not going to be undone. You know, he's going to set it up. And he's going to go home and rewrite a sermon now. He's good. I got a couple of announcements to give you. In the back, we've got the resource table back there. And we've got two resource tables. One is some big word, and all sorts of sermons, flash drives, all right? And all sorts of things back there. And then there's one from Verity, and we've got different CDs and things that you can get there. One thing that I want to highlight is we have a soul-winning seminar that our church did, and then Pastor Anderson and Paul Wittenberger helped put it on DVD. If you've never gone through a structured soul-winning training, you need to grab this, all right? And we want to give this to you for free. We don't charge for anything back there. We don't make the house of God a house of merchandise. So please grab one on your way out. We've got desserts in the break room, all right? We've got desserts and favorite food right here. So please stick around for that. Tomorrow morning, we got soul winning, 9:30 a.m. Make sure you're here and get a part of that. Don't not come because you say, well, I don't know what to say. We'll partner you with someone. We'll take care of that. Make sure you tell Pastor Anderson how great of a job he did. And don't forget, if you're a pastor's wife, meet at noon for the pastor's wife high tea. You're a pastor, even if you're not a speaker, you're invited to lunch. Mia's here at one also. And also for you pastors, if you do me a favor, tomorrow just look in the mirror before you leave the hotel
and make sure your tie's straight and you look the sharpest you can. We want to take a picture of all the pastors. And we need to get, that'd be a nice picture, wouldn't it? With all these preachers that are here united. And we got to get that picture while we're all still friends, you know what I mean? So tomorrow we're going to get a picture right here, and we want to be able to give that to you as a gift also later on. For being part of the conference. God bless you. Thank you for being here. We're going to have Brother Al come up and lead us in one last song before we're dismissed. Don't forget desserts, and don't forget the resource table. Soul winning 9:30, service at 7 p.m. Thank you for being here, Brother Al. Come lead us in one last song, and then please pray a blessing for the meal.
Amen. Let's sing song number 343. Song number 343, revive us again. Song number 343. Song number 343, sing it out on the first.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now alive.
Yeah.
I like it. Thank you.
they started popping beats. I really appreciate it. If it's on the main channel, it's probably. Because I'm putting anything questionable on, I'm not. I'm moving over to a different. Oh man, this thing's dying of power. I think we've still been live this whole time. I don't know. How do you end the. Oh, finish.